Thank you, everyone, for showing up virtually for discussion of this great, great movie. And Ramin, thank you for taking the time.
Guillermo, thank you. Thank you for taking the time. You know, I'll never forget seeing Pan's Labyrinth for the first time. I was still studying films. I had not made a film. And I'll never forget that moment, seeing that film on a big screen.
And I'll never forget that you're younger than me now. 10 years.
I just started later than you. That's all. I'm not younger. I just started later.
I'm thinner. And,
it's good to see you. I think we saw each other 2 years ago, and I'm happy to see you again. Thank you for doing this.
Same here. My pleasure. Listen, to start right away, because I think it's a beast of a movie to try to wrangle from any angle. I mean, you really is like riding a mechanical bull and trying to hold on. The structure of the film and the theme of the film, all this thematically is very much of a piece of other of your concerns that you have repeated over. But there's interesting changes, particularly when I compare it, for example, 99 Homes, which starts with an innocent protagonist, also, you know, and a learning curve, but then a decision that is both ethical and moral, and ends up basically saying, if you make the right choice, there is a little bit of glimmer, blah, blah, blah. This one is brutal. It's a two punch in the face. You're down. The world is this. But ultimately, they are almost bookends of a thought. How did you encounter the project? Because I know you have three more producers. You know, you have Mukul, you have Priyanka, and you have Ava. Fantastic team. But tell me a little bit of the genesis on what made you say, I got to make this movie.
Well, it's a strange story. I'm friends with the author, Arvind Adiga, and we've been friends since college. So it's a 25-year friendship. It started back at Columbia University in the early 90s, mid 90s. And our friendship grew out of books and movies, really. He always says that one of the ways we became friends was I showed him Mean Streets and wouldn't stop talking in the middle of the movie. And, you know, so we just started a friendship and traded scripts and books over the years. And so I read a rough draft of The White Tiger almost 4 years before it was published. And so in a way I'd been waiting, you know, 15 years to make the film. And, you know, so I just kind of felt I knew it. You know, I had read it so many times and had thought about it for so long. And about 4 or 5 years ago, Arvind said, would you like to make a movie of this? I said, yes, I've been waiting for the moment that you would say it was a good time to do it. And tracked down Mukul. He was the rights holder in India. And thankfully he liked me and liked my films. And you know, we took it off from there.
So, who had the rights at the moment?
Yeah, Mukul had the rights in India. He had been working on it for a while, but had not been able to get it made. And then when I came, we took it to Netflix. And, you know, in a way that was a good reason that it took a while to make the movie, because it's a huge movie, right? It's a big epic story with, you know, a lot of scenes and a lot going on. We needed real money. And, you know, I think back in 2008 when it was published, I don't know if I could have found financing for a movie in India on that scale with a all Indian cast, you know, with this kind of themes, but Netflix was ready to do it through Scott Stuber's division. And, you know, we were able to make the film.
And Priyanka and Ava?
Priyanka actually came after me when she heard the movie was gonna get made. She had read the book and loved it. And she was also producing films now in India and in the West, trying to find things with some social relevance, or maybe women directors or directors that don't normally get a shot. And we had a meeting and we just got along immediately. You know, she was so, she's so smart. She's so passionate. She's dedicated. She's humble, nice. And, you know, she also wanted to act in the movie. And so I said, look, would you be willing to do an audition with me? Just me and you, I'll do it with my cell phone. Mm-hmm. And she did. And she was awesome. Her instincts for the character were just spot on. And so we took it from there. And then in post-production, Ava saw a cut of the movie. We'd known each other for a while through Roger Ebert. And she saw a cut of the film, had some good thoughts. And then a conversation started about, could she be a part of the movie? Could she, you know, help us try to get the film out there? She knew Netflix. She could help us navigate the release of the film, which is a tremendous help. You know, she's such a leader in trying to get these kind of films out into the world while also directing her own amazing films. I don't know how she does all this stuff. I can't comprehend it.
I can't comprehend it either. She's a force of good for sure. Yeah. And a great person to guide you through all this.
Totally. You know?
And I think what is interesting is you're saying something that I find compelling, that is, this is a moment, we're in the crossroads of storytelling in many ways. The pandemic showed us that we can do without this, without that, without X, without Y, but certainly stories is what we need the most. As simply, we're an animal that tells stories.
Yeah.
And what I love about the movie is that it breaks all barriers. You have Ava, you have yourself, your family is half Iranian, correct?
Yeah, my parents are from Iran.
Both from Iran.
Yeah.
And Iran, India have a complex relationship.
Yes.
But you embraced it with the universality of the theme and saying, I'm going to take it from here. I was saying Dickensian in originally, but the funny thing is Dickens seems to have an infallible faith on class. It's almost like if you're born from a certain class and you fall through misadventures into other families, eventually class will recognize you for what you are. And this is a world that is brutal, a world that is merciless, and how this character, fantastic character, recognizes his ferocity and his predatory nature. And we are with him at a moment in which it's too late for us to turn around. I mean, at that moment, you're with him. Whatever he does, you're going to be.
That was the hope, but you know, I didn't know. I didn't know if that would work or not. You know, I know the novel was a huge hit, right? And I know a lot of people loved it and went along with it, but I knew people, I had met people who were like, they turned their back on him in the novel. So I had no idea what was gonna happen. In fact, we were talking before this started about your new project and how much, you know, you cut out of a movie when you're shooting. And of course, we have to cut stuff out. The area that I cut the most was actually leading up to the murder. I think I had hedged my bets that we might need more scenes to make sure an audience would go with him into that moment.
I understand.
But along the way, I kept throwing them out, you know?
Well,
it seemed like he got there without him.
I think that we seem sometimes to not realize the power of the voice of storytelling audiovisually, which is ultimately there is a moment in which if the movie is well told and there's flow, flow being the hardest thing to master, right? The audience starts internalizing the voice of the movie. I remember seeing Psycho for the first time when I was a kid and not knowing that Anthony Perkins was a murderer, spoilers ahead, but then seeing it again and being equally scared about the car sinking in the swamp.
Yeah.
Now fully knowing that he was the killer, of course, and so forth. Because, you know, and Hitchcock used to say, once the audience identifies with the character, you can make it do anything.
Yeah.
Not the filmmaker, maybe, but the character, yes. And this character, you have the trap of you want him to succeed.
Yeah.
You want him to succeed in the Western idea of success. So you are an accomplice. The 99 Homes too, in a strange way.
Yeah, I think so. I think in 99 Homes, you're with Garfield no matter what he's going to do. I mean, I think here, I agree with what you're saying. And also there's the power of the actor, right? Like when you have like the lead actor here, Adarsh, he was just so likable. He was so, you could connect with him so easily. His face, his expression, his mannerisms. He had some ability to draw you in. And I saw that in the auditions, but also on set. Like I would rearrange things based on whatever improvisations, you know, he wanted to do. In general, on the set, it was like hyper preparation and had a sense of what I wanted to do. I knew what the shots were. I knew what the lenses I wanted to use. But then it was just telling the actor, search for other ways to do it. What else is in this scene? Could you do it a different way? You know, and Adarsh used to always come to me and say, I have an idea, I want to try such a, and I would just stop him from telling me. I said, don't tell me, just do it. Do it, let me be the first audience to watch it. Believe me, the camera will figure it out. Just do it and surprise me. And he always had that about him. And I think that really helped. It helped me and the audience, I hope, to connect to him, you know?
But there's also, I mean, we've seen it through the ages. Daryl Zanuck used to say, well, the way we can identify with Jimmy Cagney as he ascends is because we can connect the audience with certain traits, like he loves his mother. Okay, yeah. let's graft onto that and tell this gangster ascent story. And this one is so ritualistic and structuralized, his humiliation.
Yeah.
Not belonging to that world. It's more than aspiration. It's almost like accessing a different dimension.
Yeah.
Reality, like transforming the world.
Well, he's also special, right? Like you understand early on, he had an ability to be more. You know, he was smart. He got pulled out of the school. There's so many antagonists around him, and he seems so much smarter than all of them, you know, and so much better than all of them. That kind of the hope was you would think he deserves to be ahead of all these people, you know.
But his intellect is so cruel in a way. I mean, which is what I find very interesting. Of course, he was bred by a structure that he saw destroy his father.
Yeah.
Basically says, well, there's a drive in him that will not stop at ethics or morals. And he ascends adhering to the ritual of his class. However, massaging the feet, serving the food, being, you know, but he's playing it and is so scary when he turns, when he reveals himself to the other chauffeur, the Muslim
chauffeur. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And he is completely nonchalant, is not conflicted about it. So that intelligence is cruel. How did you know that this actor could do those turns and not lose the audience?
Well, I had a good feeling in the auditions with him. He came in, like, I had a feeling I wanted an actor that wasn't known. I didn't want a star from the Western diaspora. I didn't want a star in Bollywood either. I wanted kind of a newcomer, and he was a newcomer. He just, when he came into the room, I'll never forget, he squatted down on his haunches. That's how he sat to say hello to me. And I thought to myself, my God, I know this. I've seen this in Iran. This is how people sit in Iran. So immediately he felt that way. And when he smiled, he lit up the room. You know, there was something.
Of course.
Yeah, he had that for the camera. But then when he wasn't smiling, I felt he was thinking. And so in the auditions, when I like an actor, I like to read with them myself, and I like to go wildly off book. He went anywhere I took the scene, he could follow it. And it always felt like he was in the moment and that he was thinking. And his ability to think and listen, I thought, were really impressive, you know? And that was kind of of course we tested and tested and tested. He didn't just get the roles too quickly, but through a lot of tests, I just believed in him. And he fully dedicated himself to the part. The hard part was the editing, because it was editing in COVID. Exactly the scene you mentioned when he turns on that other driver, the Muslim driver. I really had no idea. Like, I couldn't invite people into an edit room and watch the movie over four people's shoulder. I couldn't do it. So you were just sending links to director friends and trying to get feedback. And it was a moment that I wasn't sure about until the end. In fact, I added a shot there. I added a shot of him in his office thinking, like contemplating it as if he had some feeling of remorse about it. I put that shot in the edit room thinking, maybe I'm going to need this to make sure an audience doesn't trip up in this one moment.
And what happened?
Well, I don't know. The shot's in the movie. Guillermo, I've never seen this movie with anyone.
Never seen it with an audience. Well, listen, that's a curse and a blessing, because at the same time, in working with Netflix, you are not going to go through the marketing screenings where people are going to tell you to take out what actually could make the movie. You know, the obstacle and the path are almost inevitably the same thing. in an artistic expression. And a lot of the time, the process strangulates that out of a movie. You don't have to go through that. You don't have to go through the good part because of COVID, but you didn't have to go through any of the terrifying things, you know? And one of the things I noticed in your structure, which probably came in the editing, I wanted to ask you, we spent a long, long, long time on his ascension.
Yeah.
Very, very long. And then the end comes very swiftly, very swift. The third act, so to speak, is very short.
Yeah.
And you want it to be short, frankly. I was transported because I was not having to now go with him. It's almost like everything else was conducive to that murder.
Yeah.
So there's no terrifying need to squeeze it. The suspense out of the audience. We're with him.
Yeah.
But is this a structure that came at screenplay or at editing?
You mean from the murder to the end?
Yeah, like deciding to spend so much more on the ascension and then going fast on the third act.
Yeah, I mean, there were more scenes for sure. There were a lot of scenes before the murder that I threw away in the edit room. And then...
Because you felt you didn't need them? Or
didn't need them anymore. Like it started to feel like we already knew it. What I didn't know, in the novel, the way Arvind wrote it, he tells you that he murders his master in the first chapter. So you know what he's going to do right off the bat. And that was the first draft of the script. In the second draft, I got rid of that so that the audience wouldn't know. And I moved the hit and run accident to the beginning as a way to misdirect the audience to think he's wanted by the police because of this accident with the kid. And then when I started screening it for friends, editing process, I came to realize that it worked. Like even after the hit and run accident, for a long period, people still seemed to think that he was wanted for murder for the kid. They didn't really know he was going to kill his master until maybe 10, 20 minutes before that.
Yes.
So in the editing, I threw scenes away because I started to get a feeling people were getting too far ahead and they were waiting too long. And then the hard part was the post-murder in his time as an entrepreneur in Bangalore, where he's recounting his trajectory to become successful. That was probably, 4 or 5 minutes longer. And I kept tightening that because I figured the movie's over now. How much longer can people wait here?
Of course.
Yeah, yeah.
The interesting thing, there are two things that I feel make it almost like a neon noir.
Yeah.
A very strange noirish thing. Obviously, one is inevitably, when you open the first page of a James M. Cain novel, you know a murder will be inevitable.
Yeah.
Of course it'll happen. It'll happen, and most of the time, whether it's Serenade or the Postman, you know that the character that is leading you is a flawed man, to say the least, you know? And you go with it, and you know it's inevitable, and you know it's going to happen. And then I'm thinking of Ripley, the Patricia Highsmith's
character. Sure.
Ripley.
Yeah.
But Ripley is pretending to be something he's not, and here, the same way that Ripley has almost delightfully emotional, almost erotic relationships with people that he's exploiting, this character does the same, but keeping an almost secret identity, like he's in Kabbalistic terms, his true name, his true nature, which is the White Tiger, he keeps it inside, and through it he sees Raj's character as his superior, almost in a love story.
Definitely.
And as an unworthy superior. Therefore, he hates him because he should be destroyed, because there's no more unworthy master than that. You know, so this is a really complex, not Dostoevskian riddled with guilt. It's a very modern character.
I used to think in the writing of the script when I was working with my partner, we would talk about how at a certain point he realizes he can't stay a servant to this man because that man is weak. And how strong could he be as a servant if his master is weak? So eventually he would have to destroy him. And certainly the I was of course thinking also about Ripley, also Joseph Losey's servant.
Of course.
Yeah. And the camera movement in that film is so good.
And the mirror.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the scene in the mirror, I was thinking about the René Clément version, Plan Soleil, the purple noon.
With Alain Delon, yeah.
God, the use of sunlight in that movie is so good.
Astounding.
Yeah, and he has that sequence in the mirror where Delon is putting on the clothes and then suddenly his master shows up. So there was definitely all of that. Yeah, he's more worthy. There used to even, in fact, be a voiceover where he said something like that, and then I cut it out.
It is interesting that he is incapable of rebelling against the mongoose, or incapable of rebelling against true savage brutish power, but the moment he identifies that weakness in Raj, he immediately projects himself. Inevitably, he hates Raj because he hates the weakness of his position. But the moment of the murder, it could have been milked for 5 minutes, the tire, a phone call, or this or that, and you make it shockingly brief, which frankly, I thought made it all the more effective. Was this deliberate from screenplay, or did you find it in the staging?
No, it was kind of like that in the script. It got shorter in the edit. It was a bit more graphic in the edit, and it seemed unnecessary, that part of it. The main thing for me on the murder was I knew I wanted it to be handheld and intimate with them. I really wanted it to be for you to feel that it was Balram killing Ashok. But I also wanted this one wide shot from a distance on a medium lens that would be at 96 frames with the rain. And I wanted that to be epic, because I wanted to somehow get the feeling of intimate but epic. So it would be Balram killing Ashok, but also the servant class killing the master class, or the slave killing the owner. You know, that battle of rich and poor, that centuries journey. Yeah. I wanted that to be in the wide at slow motion.
The epic shot.
The epic quality.
Because it is an entire, as people say, when an epic is not the story of hundreds of thousands of extras, is the story of one man that becomes, you know, that represents an entire race or an entire condition.
Totally.
And, you know, the other part that I thought the novel must have had and the movie has is a very Buñuelian sense of cruelty, because Buñuel used to say, I'd rather side with blind brutishness than with blind charity. Blind charity, you know, and Raj.
Viridiana.
Viridiana, of course. Nasarin is the perfect example.
Yeah.
But there's a great thing. Pinky comes, sees, and says, farewell, guys. This doesn't work for me, right? Raj, who has been in theory Americanized, come, sees, and in spite of his conscience, he stays.
Yeah.
And he bends to it. And that makes him, in the Buñuelian sense, a despicable man.
Yeah.
Because the mongoose doesn't know better.
Yeah.
Basically was reared like that.
Well, also he says who he is from the beginning. The mongoose is a tough from the very beginning. He never pretends, you know? I mean, okay, he pretends a little bit in the forced confession when he says, aren't we brothers? Don't we have meals together? But yeah, for me, that was the scene of Raj and Adarsh in the mosquito net, where he comes down to visit him drunk and he says, oh, you live here, I'm gonna do something. And he sings, and he's so pathetic in singing. This was all in the script, but then the actor, Adarsh, said, can I sing also? I said, oh, you want to sing too? He said, yeah. I said, go ahead. I need to be able to have the rights to whatever you're singing. So he went into the corner with the script supervisor, and the script supervisor wrote 4 or 5 lines of poetry. And then Adarsh made this tune to it, and he created the singing in that moment.
He composed it.
It just made it right there, and we just started filming it. And it was incredible because he was such a good singer that the whole crew became mesmerized by him. And it was, again, another example of how he was superior to his master. And then his master said something like, you know, you're such a sweet, simple man. I wish I had a life like you. This actually came earlier in the scene and I re-edited it to put it at the very end because it was so condescending, you know, that moment. I like that scene anyway.
It is interesting because when one of the most conciliatory things for the uncommitted soul, for the soul that thinks that or pretends to be good but is not, because it's lazy goodness, is to simplify the other, right? To make the person simple or musical or generous. Oh, you know, he has nothing but he's happy. These platitudes that justify their richness and their position. The same happens in a way with his sexual dimension. You know, when he touches himself or he's dirty, all of a sudden they treat him like an accessory again. You know, even Pinky is ambivalent about it. Oh, you know, he's such a great guy. Oh, we shouldn't do that. We shouldn't do that. And she toys with him. And the night before the accident, because the way he's dressed,
that's right,
like a mascot. I mean, yeah. Really, I tell you, the thing with the movie is like trying to grab a razor blade, and that's what I love. I love that the movie doesn't have a simple, one-sided, black and white message to deliver. It's about the incredibly complex times we live in, which are at the same time a very formal behavior and an incredible amount of rage coinciding at the same time. And this movie is so much this moment. The screenplay, developing it, how close did you work together with McCool?
Yeah, we worked closely on it. I mean, we had a good vision for it when we first spoke. You know, I remember in our first call, he was in Mumbai and I was in Brooklyn. I remember at the end of the call, he said, how do you see the ending? And I said, honestly, I think it should have some feeling of celebration to the main character, despite what he's done, because what he's done is there. It's not going to go away. The audience is going to feel that. But I want to push him up despite what he's done, because that's how the book felt to me when I read it. And he liked that a lot because he felt the same way. So, you know, I was writing in Brooklyn the whole time and he was in Mumbai. And then I have another partner in Paris, an Iranian woman named Azimi. She was the co-writer of Chop Shop and Goodbye Solo and 99 Homes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So she's always been there. She was, again, she's the one who probably gets the most phone calls. And what I learned now in editing a movie is you can film your screen and film scenes on the monitor on WhatsApp and send two versions, three versions, and get immediate feedback.
Oh, really? That's fantastic.
It's great, yeah. You get quick feedback. Which version is better, this one or this one? And you get feedback.
But it's interesting. We're talking about the ending. And I remember when I first saw Jean Renoir's La Chien, which was then remade by Fritz Lang with Edward G. Robinson. You know, the main point of difference of the two movies, in my opinion, is the ending. In the original, in the French version, it ends with the man that has killed his lover talking to another vagabond. They are both destroyed, ravaged by alcohol and abandonment and so forth. And he says, finally, in a very Dostoevskian way, he says, I killed a woman. And then the other guy says, well, one has to do a little of everything in this life. And that's it. Whereas in the American version with Fritz Lang, it ends up with G. Robinson walking away in the guilt and the echo of the crimes. And what I love is there is an incredibly powerful moment in the movie where he says, even if they get me, I'm at peace.
Yeah.
Because I knew for a moment what it was.
Yeah.
You know? And yeah. Is that in the novel?
And
Yeah,
that's in the novel. And also the last scene, the last scene is even more, I think, modern, because he says the real nightmare is not that you're being chased by the man you murdered. The real nightmare is that you didn't do it, that you didn't kill that man and you're still a servant. And that part of the novel was so brilliant. It was like because I love Dostoevsky, Arvind and I used to talk about Dostoevsky, but this flipped it upside down, you know?
Of course. Yeah.
And in the novel, he's just thinking all these things. It's a first person narration, the novel, right? So it's all in his head, which is kind of difficult to translate to a script because you've got to develop all the other characters and you've got to give them their own lives. And so the movie has broken the fourth wall, but I wanted something different for the very ending. I wanted him to just start talking to the drivers, whether he's really talking to them or it's in his head. That's up to the audience to decide for themselves. But I thought it would be good if he talked to the drivers. And I remember Balram asking, like, what do you mean exactly? And I said, did you ever see Last Temptation of Christ, the Scorsese film? He said, yeah. I said, like that. You're talking to these disciples. You're trying to tell them your vision, you know? And
indoctrinate them into the new gospel.
Yeah. Something like that, yeah.
It is a savage movie. We're going to go to the audience questions. So, you know.
I like that you talk about these Cagney movies because
it is.
I love Cagney's performances. They're so bold and wild, you know?
But I think, in my opinion, is one of my favorite actors of all time.
Yeah, me too.
One of my favorites to watch. I remember he said, because he was a short man, and he said, every time I look at someone taller, I give him the eyes, but not the chin. he never looked up. And it's such a simple thing, but I think that existentially, your character gives him the eye. But
yeah, sure. Well, my actor's also short. He's not very tall.
That's what I mean, yes.
I love that. You mentioned Roaring Twenties, and I love that. I love Raoul Walsh.
What a film.
Regeneration. I love Regeneration.
To me, the gangster epic is an amazing American invention, like the musical, so many other things. And the way it allows for a class release of steam is incredible. I mean, in the American way, it allows things to stay the same, but at the same time provokes an enormous release for rage. Here's a few questions. Anonymous, how did you define the color palette, you and your cinematographer, which he is Italian, right?
Yeah, he's Italian, yeah.
Let's talk about this. We're going to work with the pre-production. Did you use a lookbook? This is the question. So if you want to talk a little about that.
Yeah, I mean, definitely we had a lot in the lookbook from me, from the cinematographer Paolo, from Chad, the production designer. In fact, they were almost the only people that came with me from the West. The crew was 99% Indian. I just brought one production designer under the condition that he would not bring anyone else. He had to use an entirely Indian crew, and he loved that idea. And then Paolo came from Italy with a Steadicam operator and a first AC, and then his whole department, the gaffer, the grips, they were all Indian. And, you know, we wanted to take the audience to different worlds. So the village was going to have one look. It was, the village itself was quite yellow. That's just what it was. And there was a lot of dust and mud there. So that just matched it. And, you know, we had a heavier grain in that section, a 16mm grain. And it was all handheld, that part. So even if the camera was on a dolly, it was on a dolly handheld.
Of course. And,
on
a sandbag or.
Exactly, on a sandbag. And trying to use, like, I wanted the tone of the novel was so fun and funny, despite how full of rage it is or how serious the tone is, the subject is, it was fun. And I wanted to maintain that, especially in the first half. So even a simple shot of people sleeping at night, you know, the camera would go quickly here, and it would discover people in a wide lens right near the frame, just to keep it a little bit playful. Mm-hmm. Donbad, the next section in that rich villa, this big white kind of castle with this green palm trees. We wanted that on dollies and steady cams on wide frames so that we would see this man in this big palace.
The surrounding, yeah.
Yeah. And then for Delhi, the main thing was to differentiate upstairs, downstairs. So upstairs had this kind of gaudy colors that we discovered in kind of design and architecture books of rich homes in India and Dubai and other places like that. And the downstairs, we looked really at Chris Doyle's work in Fallen Angels, the Wong Kar Wai film, to find some of those like ugly neons and piss yellow or green or whatnot. And the final section in Bangalore, when he's a master, you know, we tried to reserve all glass buildings for that portion. You know, I saw an escalator on a scout and I was like, an escalator? I remember when my dad from a village in Iran for the first time saw an escalator and it was completely confused. So I thought I should put this guy on an escalator, you know, because it's so modern for him.
But when I was a kid, one of the big attractions on a Sunday was a store that had gotten the first electric escalator.
Yeah.
Oh, to ride it. Yeah.
I mean, all these things I knew from my dad because he grew up in a village like Balram's, and I had lived in that village. I lived in Iran for many years. And so in that section of him as an entrepreneur, we had a lot of Steadicam movement, a lot. We wanted to express his confidence that he moved and demanded a different kind of energy now as an entrepreneur. So there was a lot of movement in that part.
Your decision to bring an Italian to do this, rather than seeking somebody British, Indian, whatever it is, why was he the perfect Paolo?
I really liked his, well, he's a veteran DP, but I discovered his work by watching this series called Gamora, which I really liked, based on the movie that I really liked, based on the book that I really liked. Again, a gangster story that I like gangster
stories. Great writer, yeah.
Yeah, totally. And I watched some of his feature films, which were great. And so I did a TV pilot and I brought him onto that to see what it would be like to work with him. And we got along great. And what I love about his work is he's a master of light, but he gives me freedom because I don't like to put marks down for my actors. Oh. I like them to discover their own blocking. And I like to rethink my shots if I need to. Often you don't. Often they kind of do what you think they're going to do. But whenever they do something different, I'll rearrange myself accordingly. And he was able to give me incredible light and color and darkness when I needed it. But he didn't make me start and stop all the time. I could keep shooting.
It's interesting what you say, because I always say staging with the actors, if you're really cooperative and intelligent, because you want to collaborate with the actor, you want to, is 50% chess, 50% tennis match.
How do you mean?
What I mean is you have calculated a fallback plan. This is how we're going to do it if nothing else happens. And then when it happens, you got to be agile and return to serve.
Totally. Totally.
You don't have to see it. Of course you don't have to see it. Of course you can be in the car. Don't step out. That's a great idea. You have to recognize that. And that's beautiful. And a lot of DPs can be an influence where that gets suffocated. Directors ourselves can suffocate it.
I totally agree. Yes, exactly. And he allowed me that. And I did the test run on the pilot and he let me do it there too. So I, exactly what you said. If an actor wants to jump somewhere else, let them go.
Anyway, if he's out of the light, he's out of the light.
Yeah. You know?
The next question is, working from such a beloved book, what were the biggest challenges in adapting this for the screen? Were there any part left out that you missed? And I'll add a question to that question. And what parts are completely original to the script that do not, major parts, are there any that don't exist in the book? So let's answer Michael.
The hardest part really was the tone for me that I mentioned earlier. I had never done that before.
No.
So yeah, trying to balance that tone of sarcasm and character and thriller and murder, and also how he loses his mind, you know, in the second half. In the novel, it's even wilder. He starts to talk to animals and he goes even more nutty in the book. But so there were real risks there in things I had never done before. For example, in one moment, he tells his master, "I want to smash your skull and steal your money."
Yes.
Yeah. In the novel, he thinks it. And in the film, I decided that he should just say it. And the master just will respond as if he hasn't heard it. And I was just going with my hope that an audience would understand he didn't really say it, but that we were so invested in him as a character that we would get it. And of course there were other tricks. There was some strange lights on this window and I added some sound and some strange sounds in that area. And then it goes into a sequence where he's, one of my favorite scenes where he squats in a slum with a man who's taking a crap.
Yeah, and takes a crap, right?
Because it's in the novel, actually. And I thought, when in my life will I ever get to shoot a scene like this? And I don't know if it's real. I don't know if it's really happened. But so doing those kind of scenes were...
It's curiously enough, an act of life, an act of rage, an act of evacuation.
Yeah.
It's one of the most powerful moments in the movie, precisely, I think, because it's not ascribed a definite meaning.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, we didn't know. I remember that the poor actor was tormented that day. He thought it was the worst thing he had ever done. For days and days and days, he kept telling me, can we please do it again? Don't use it. And finally, when he saw the movie, he still didn't know. He didn't know if it was good or not, but I kept telling him, I'm telling you, it's a weird and good scene, you know?
It is. I think the price comes disguised as the downfall.
Yeah.
Always. Yeah. Always the price is a downfall.
Well, I figured some part of it was just the idea that he was realizing how close he was to being that man in that slum if he didn't do something.
Yes. Now, he's asking how, working from the beloved book, what was the biggest challenge, would you say?
Yeah, the tone, for sure.
And tone is something...
How do you deal with tone? Because you're a master at it, because you've got so many genres and styles.
And well, what I think is one of the two things that are hardest to explain outside of the working, talking shop is tone and flow.
Yeah.
Which I think David Lean said, all film is transitions, right? Is the one thing film has as an art form. And the other thing, tonally, when you can go completely insane and completely moving, completely funny, within the space of 10 minutes, you can only know when you learn by failing in a strange way. And that's what's remarkable about the film. It's a huge jump for you as a director, massive. And the ambition worked, the aim worked, but boy, was that a jump.
And oh, thanks.
Did you ever feel nervous?
Weirdly, no. I thank you for saying that, but I learned like in every movie, you learn so much. Because the novel is somehow fun to read, I kept telling myself, because I'm not necessarily a fun person, and making a movie isn't always fun. It's sometimes quite nerve-wracking. Yeah. And you're focused and there's steam coming out of your head because you're trying to really focus. I kept telling myself, I gotta have fun making this movie or it won't be fun for an audience. And somehow I'd never thought of that before, that if you actually enjoy it, making it, it might actually be more enjoyable to watch, which yeah. is like, I don't know why, no one told me. Why didn't you tell me this one time?
There's all sorts of results, I must tell you.
It doesn't always work.
Results may vary. Now let me ask you, there's another one here that says, were there any shots or revelations that you discovered in the edit that surprised you or made a great shift on the story? This is from Deborah.
God, what hard questions. I mean, there is so much in the editing. The stuff that surprised, some of the things that surprised me in the editing were things that I thought I would never cut that got cut.
Of course.
That was really surprising.
That always happens to me.
Yeah.
My favorite crane, the masterful, oh, look at that shot.
Goodbye. Gone. Yeah, gone. That's always surprising. I mean, it took a long time to edit. I think we were editing from January almost till November. I'd never spent this much time editing a movie. Yeah, it just kept going on and on and on for some reason.
Do you edit during the shoot?
I had an editor cutting during the shooting period. And then I came back to Brooklyn in January and I started editing in one room and Tim was editing in another room. Mm-hmm. And then in March, everybody left and I was the only one in the edit room editing and he was editing from home. And then we would just work like that. I would cut one reel and he would cut a different reel and then we would trade the reels back and forth.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of awesome because you get two different people cutting the same movie and you trade it and you just keep talking and eventually whoever has the better idea wins on that scene, you know?
Always.
Yeah, it's great.
I always invite people into the editing room and I actually say to them, today you are the master. Because if I say no, I said, we won't argue anything. you got anything you want.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll never see it, right? And, and trading reels is the perfect way to do it.
I love that. Do you do that?
Oh, a lot.
Do you edit yourself also?
No, I only when it's absolutely necessary. I did it a little in Kronos, a little on Mimic on the off days.
Yeah.
But other than that, I don't ever tell the editor which one is my favorite take.
Me neither.
Because once I shoot the movie, I want to see what other people see in it.
I know. I tell the editor from the beginning, I'm not going to tell you anything about what I think, and I'm not going to tell the script supervisor any notes either. Nothing. You should do whatever you want. I have a feeling of what I want, but I want to know what you want.
I mean, I have perfect memory of the takes, and I'll say, no, in three, he blinked in that line, and we can go then there. But the same when I invite somebody into the editing room, I sometimes leave them alone. I say, you work with the editor, I'll come back later. Because I want it to be savage. You have, when you write, you hate the producer. When you direct your screenplay, you hate the writer. You know, and when you edit, you hate the director. You go, what are you thinking, right?
Of course. One time, Oliver Stone asked me to watch one of his movies. He was editing, and I gave a couple of notes, and he said, "Just sit here for the next week and do whatever you want." I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, go ahead. If I like it, I'll take it. If I don't, I won't."
That happened with a good friend of mine. I shall not say the name, but I've done that a couple of times. And he says, "No, do whatever." And of course, then whatever they take, and whatever they don't, which is good.
What do you mean when you say flow?
Flow. What I mean is when you start making a movie, when you are really, really early, it happened to me in the first few. It's hard to make the one scene lead like a wave to the next one.
Yeah.
And a lot of times you make them too complete. Like you start it in middle and it ends.
Yeah.
And then there comes another scene after that. But it's not it's a scene and a scene and a scene. And when you don't even know when the scene ended and the next one is already halfway, that's flow.
Yeah.
And it's about theme and it's about tone and it's about so many things. Is the musical element, I think, of filmmaking. I think is the symphonic element of filmmaking. And it's very hard to explain without going into the workshop, and they're telling me we're over. But
let me ask you one more question about flow.
Mm-hmm.
When you're doing that in the editing, are you doing that with a temp soundtrack or are you doing it without the soundtrack?
The last three movies I've edited without temp music. Because I used to edit with temp music and then you fell in love with it.
Yeah.
Right. And now I fall in love with no music. And then when the score comes, I it's a revelation. Because I the same thing, I try to spot with the musician, but I also say, you come back and tell me where we need it, because I don't think it's about covering anything. It's about revealing something I haven't seen. You know, so when I say the musical element, I mean, I think all cinema aspires to be music, like aspires to be a song or a symphony or something. And the flow is where it reveals its dimension, its intent, its power, you know, and that's why I think your movie is such a massive leap. We could watch your last three one day with pizza and some...
I can't wait to watch your next symphony. I tell you, I cannot wait to watch your next symphony.
Well, we're orchestrating right now.
Nice.
All right, guys. Well, listen, thank you, everyone that came. Thank you for all the questions. I mean, I love talking to you. We should do it again. And congratulations on a great film.
Guillermo, thanks so much.
Thank you, my friend.
Bye-bye.